Highbridge Audio presents Gap Creek, written by Robert Morgan and read by Jill Hill. I know about my senior because I was there. I seen him die. We didn't tell anybody the truth because it seemed so shameful the way he died. It was too awful to describe to other people, but I was there, even though I didn't want to be. And I seen it all. Monsignor was my little brother, my only brother, and us girls had spoiled him. If Monsignor woke up in the middle of the night and wanted some hot cornbread, one of us would get up and bake it. If Monsignor wanted a pretty in the store in town, we'd carry a chicken down to one of the big houses in Flat Rock and sell it to buy him the pretty. Monsignor got an egg every morning, while the rest of us just had grits. I thought Monsignor was the cutest boy in the world. He had these blonde curls that stood out all around his head, and his eyes was blue as the mountains in the far distance. Now, the year I'm talking about was the year after Cold Friday, that day when the sun never did come out and it never warmed up. Cold Friday was the coldest day anybody had ever seen. It seemed like the end of the world when the chickens never left the roost, and it put such a chill on everything, we'll never forget that day. Papa took his coughing sickness then, and it seemed like he never was well after that. But it was a year after Cold Friday when Monsignor started acting poorly. Along in the winter, Monsignor started to look peaked. He fell off a lot, and Mama thought it was because the cow was dry, so we borrowed milk from the millers that lived further out on the ridge. But the milk didn't seem to help Monsignor. He got paler, and he lost his baby fat. It was the day after Christmas when he woke up with the pains. My sister Rosie heard him holler out, and she went to his bed in the attic. "My belly hurts," he said. "Have you got the colic?" Rosie said. "Hurts bad," Monsignor said. Everybody knows what you take for colic is pennyroyal tea, and Mama boiled some as soon as the stove was hot, even before she cooked any breakfast. Monsignor sipped the tea, and it seemed to make him feel better. Maybe because Mama put a little paregoric in the tea, the way you do for babies with the colic. Papa said, "Too much store-bought candy will always give a body colic." But after that, Monsignor got the colic even when he didn't have any store-bought candy. After the Christmas candy was long gone, he still had the terrible cramps and would wake up in the middle of the night crying. Mama would hold him in her lap and rock him by the fire, and Papa or one of us girls would hold him while Mama made the pennyroyal tea. Then, after he drunk the tea with some paregoric, he would feel better, and might even sleep a little. That was a bad winter, not only because it was colder than usual, but because of the ice storms and the snows. It looked like the woods had been chopped down, there were so many trees broke by the ice. And when it snowed, it was a heavy, wet snow that broke down more trees and made barns and sheds and even houses cave in. The church house at Poplar Springs fell down. Because Papa had the cough, my sister Lou and me did the heavy work outside. We got in eggs and fed the stock and carried in wood and water from the spring. I hated how everybody expected me to do the outside work. If there was a heavy job, it just naturally fell to me, and sometimes Lou, like it always had. The weather was bad so long we nearly run out of firewood. I took the axe into the woods and chopped up a blowed-down tree. And then I hitched up the horse Sally to the sled and drug in a load. My hands like to froze, it was so wet and cold. "Julie can work like a man," Mama said when I brought in a load of wood into the front room. "Somebody's got to work like a man," I said, and dropped the logs on the edge of the hearth. My hands got rough from the cold and the hard work. I rubbed grease on them at night to soften the calluses and moisten the dry skin. I would have liked to keep my hands soft, the way Rosie did hers. During the terrible winter, when Papa took chest consumption, we didn't hardly get off the mountain, and we almost ran out of cornmeal. If Papa did the least little thing, he would start coughing and get so weak he couldn't hardly sit up. He'd always been such a strong man before that it embarrassed him to be so helpless. We got down to the last peck of cornmeal in the bin, and then to the last gallon. "My senior won't get better if he don't have plenty to eat," Mama said. "And your papa won't either." "Maybe we'll freeze to death before we starve," I said. "Don't talk that way," Mama said. "You take some corn down to the mill." There was still ice on the trees and snow on the ground. I resented it, but I seen what had to be done. The road was too slick and steep for either the wagon or the sled. I couldn't carry enough corn on my back down the mountain and back up. Even if my sister Lou went with me, we couldn't carry enough between us. Lou was the toughest of my sisters. She was almost as strong as me. I saw that the only way to take a bushel of corn to mill was to sling it over the horse's back and lead her down the mountain. It would take both me and Lou to lead Sally. "Lou, you're going to have to help me," I said. "Why ain't I surprised?" Lou said. Took us all day to get down the mountain, wait for the turn of the corn to be ground while the men eyed us and told jokes, and then lead Sally back up the trail. We got home a little after dark, and the sacks was damp, but we had enough fresh meal to last a few weeks until the weather opened up and Papa was well enough to drive the wagon down the mountain. But even with plenty of cornbread and milk to eat, my senior didn't get any better. He kept falling off no matter how much he ate. And then he started to get a fever and the night sweats. He had terrible dreams that would make him holler out in the night. He yelled one time, "There is snakes dancing." And when we woke him up, he said there was a pit where snakes was swaying to music. He was so scared by his dream, he dreaded to go back to sleep. One of us had to sit up with him after he drunk his tea with paregoric. There was some long nights that winter, on into February and early March. But it was after the weather broke, after it looked like things was opening up and Papa's cough was a little better, that Monsignor took the terrible fever. One morning Mama felt him, and he was hot as a coal, and all day he just got hotter. By evening, he was talking out of his head. "Mama, why don't you have Gabriel come blow his horn?" he said. We knowed he was a little beside himself. Mama had read him a story from the Bible the night before. After it got dark, he just growed hotter. It scares you when a fever keeps going up. It's like watching somebody slide toward a brink and you can't stop them. "We've got to make him sweat," Mama said. "How do you make him sweat?" Papa said. "By wrapping him in quilts and putting pans of hot water under his bed," Mama said. "That'll just make him hotter," Papa said. "Sweating's the only thing that'll cool him off," Mama said. We got nigh every blanket in the house and piled them on Monsignor. And we heated kettles of water on the stove and in the fireplace and poured boiling water in pans which we slid under the bed. It got so hot in the house we was all sweating. I lifted the covers and looked at Monsignor. It was like his skin had closed tight, and he couldn't sweat. "He's going to die if we don't do something," Papa said. "What else can we do?" Mama said. "We can make him drink hot lemon tea," Papa said. Rosie and me squeezed some lemon juice in hot water, and they tried to make my senior drink a cup of that. But he wouldn't wake up enough to drink anything. His eyes was closed, and he wouldn't rouse. It got to be midnight, and Papa wound up the clock on the mantel. As he turned the key, he looked at Monsignor, and you could tell how worried he was. Papa was still weak himself from the lung sickness. I'll carry him to the doctor, Papa said. You can't carry him to the doctor in the middle of the night, Mama said. I'll carry him down the mountain and Julie can hold the lantern, Papa said. Papa always did depend on me when he needed something. If there was a hard job to be done, it just had to be me that done it. I don't know but what Monsignor had a catch in sickness. I was near about afraid to touch him. But why does it have to be me, I said. Because you're the strongest one in the family, Mama said, and because everybody has to do what they can. Mama always did know how to make me ashamed when I tried to get out of a job. All right, I'll do it, I said, as I always did when they expected me to do something they didn't want to do. It was a cold, clear night with the moon shining when we started out. We didn't even need the kerosene lantern in open places, but I lit the wick anyway and carried it like a pail of light down in the path in front of Papa. He toted Monsignor on his right shoulder, wrapped in a blanket. Sometimes Monsignor groaned, but he was so asleep he didn't know what was happening. When we got to the woods, we needed the lantern, and in the hollers where the moon didn't reach, it was black as a Bible. I heard a dog bark somewhere off in the woods near the Jeter place. And then something up on the mountain squalled like a person in terrible pain. What is that? I said. Nothing but a wildcat, Papa said. The scream come again, this time closer. Must be following us, I said. Just a wildcat, Papa said, and I could tell from his voice he was nigh out of breath. Here, I'll carry my senior, I said. You carry the lantern, Papa said. I'm all right. But Papa was winded. He was ashamed to admit it, but he was winded. Won't do my senior no good if you get wore out, I said. I can carry him, Papa said. He kept walking a little further, too stubborn to admit he was tired, and then he had to stop to catch his breath. Here. Let me take him, I said. I set the lantern down on the trail and turned and took my senior from Papa. I was afraid to touch him, but didn't have any choice. I slung him up against my shoulder and followed Papa down the trail. It took us over an hour to make it down the mountain. When we come out of the woods into the open country around Flat Rock, the moonlight was so bright it seemed like day. Dew on the fields sparkled like beads. I was so tired, my arms ached, and my legs trembled by the time we got to the gate of Dr. Prince's big house. His cur dog set up a growl and a bark. He come running from the porch and stood behind the gate snarling. He would have ate up anybody that come through that gate. You holler for the doctor, Papa said. Let me catch my breath, I said, and shifted my senior to my left shoulder and called out, Dr. Prance! The dog set up even a bigger fuss, and I heard a noise in the house. Hi, Dr. Prance! I shouted. A light was lit somewhere inside the house and a door open. Who is there? A voice called. This is Julie Harmon and her papa. My senior is bad sick. Is he with you? The voice called. We carried him down the mountain, I said. The doctor called the dog back and held him on the porch while we climbed the steps and went inside. The cur growled as we passed him. It was a big fancy house with high ceilings and lots of mirrors and lamps. The doctor led us into his study, which was lined with books. We laid Monsignor on the table in the middle of the room, and Dr. Prince brought a bright lamp over and looked at him. He pulled the blanket back and felt of Monsignor's pulse. How long has he had the fever? He got hot 2 nights ago, Papa said. Dr. Prince bent down and sniffed Monsignor's breath and listened to his heart. Could he have the milk sick? Too early for milk sick, Papa said. Then it must be typhoid, the doctor said. I wasn't going to say hadn't nobody else on the mountain had typhoid, but I didn't. Who was I to argue with Dr. Prince? Dr. Prince went to a shelf and got a bottle of something that looked like reddish syrup. "Let's give him a dram of this," he said. I had to hold Monsignor's head up, and Papa pried his mouth open with his fingers. But I don't think Monsignor knowed what was happening when the doctor poured the spoon of syrup in his mouth. Some dribbled out of the corners of his mouth, but I guess a little went down his throat. Monsignor was too deep asleep to know the difference. "You'll have to watch him closely," the doctor said, and handed Papa the bottle of syrup. "Every fever is different." "I'm afraid I don't have no money," Papa said.
"You can pay me later," Dr. Prince said.
It was the way the doctor said it so quick that told us he was rich and didn't need our money. "I'll bring you a dollar as soon as I sell some chickens," Papa said.
"That will be fine," Dr. Prince said.
He showed us to the door and held the big cur dog by the collar while we walked to the gate. I know Papa was tired before we ever started back up the mountain. I was wore out myself in my legs and in my back, and my arms was sore. We had 4 miles to walk still, and they was up the mountain. "Let me carry my senior," I said. "We'll take turns," Papa said. "I should carry him now on the flat ground," I said, "and you can carry him when the trail gets steep." I took my senior from Papa. The boy was dead asleep, his head laid on my shoulder. I prayed, "Lord, let us get Monsignor home. Don't let him die out here on the trail in the damp night air." I had never prayed with such a will. It was the prettiest night you ever saw, with the moonlight slanting on the creek and dew sparkling in the grass. The mountains rose like shadows ahead of us. It must have been 3 o'clock in the morning, and the mountains was so still and peaceful, you would have thought the millennium had come and all our trials was over. It was the first time I ever noticed how the way the world looks don't have a thing to do with what's going on with people. I locked my arm around my senior like I never meant to let go, and I stomped the ground hard to make my steps firm. If I had to carry him all the way up the mountain, I could. I was determined to get this over and done with. There was strength in me I had never called on, and this might be the time I had to use it. Papa lit the lantern when we got to the woods and started climbing. We had got up to where the beds of moss growed below the laurel thicket when I felt my senior stiffen in my arms. I thought he must be waking up and stretching, that the syrup the doctor had given him was having a good effect. But his back arched too stiff and fast. "Are you awake, little feller?" I said. I started to pat his back, but felt his whole body stirring.
"Is he awake?" Papa said.
"Must be," I said, for my senior was twisting in my arms like a baby that will jump even while you're holding it. But there was something wrong, because the stirring continued, and his back kept jerking. "Hold the light here," I said to Papa. Papa brought the lantern up close, and the first thing I saw was Monsignor's face. His eyes was open like he had seen something terrible, and his mouth was drawed back in a scream, but no sound come out except the gnashing of his teeth. He looked like he'd seen the awfulest thing, and it had scared him to death. "Is he dying?" I said.
"He's having a fit," Papa said.
Monsignor's feet was kicking now, and his whole body heaving. I didn't know what to do. Should I lay him down, or hurry on up the trail toward home? Should we turn and go back down the trail to the doctor's house?
"Put him down here," Papa said, and held the lantern over a bank of moss beside the trail.
I knelt down and laid Monsignor on the ground, and it was the worst sight to see him twist and kick with both legs.
I've never seen anybody have fits before. What can we do? I said, and held his head off the cold moss. I felt helpless. It was like night was crushing down on top of me. Put something between his teeth, Papa said, so he won't swallow his tongue. All I had to put between Messenger's teeth was a corner of the blanket we had wrapped him in. I folded it twice and stuck it in his mouth, which was foaming with spit. And then he coughed, and coughed again. I seen he was choking. I wondered if he had swallowed his tongue, or was he choking on his own spit. I stuck my finger in his throat to pull out the block, and I felt something rush up into his mouth. "He's strangling!" I screamed. Papa held the lantern closer, and we seen that Messenger was throwing up. White stuff come out of his mouth, and lines of white stuff. "My God," I said, for I thought he was throwing up milk or some white gravy, but what come out of his mouth was gobs of squirming things. They was worms. Wads and wads of white worms. He kept coughing and throwing up, and more come out. "He's choking," Papa said, and reached his hand into Messenger's mouth and pulled out more gobs of the things. I shuddered, looking at what he was doing. Papa dug out more worms to clean Messenger's mouth and throat, and when he stopped, Messenger's mouth was open, and his eyes was open, but he was still. "I can't breathe," I cried, and shook Messenger's chest. Papa pushed on Messenger's heart and listened to his chest. He's not breathing. "What can we do?" I said. We just looked at his little body, and I couldn't think of anything else to do. Something twitched in a nostril. It was another worm that had found its way out through his nose. I sat there on the cold ground, feeling that human life didn't mean a thing in this world. People could be born, and they could suffer, and they could die, and it didn't mean a thing. The moon was shining above the trees, and the woods was peaceful. I could hear the creek down the ridge, gentle as a dove, and the mountains was still as ever. The ground under me was solid. But little Messenger was dead. There was nothing we could do about it, and nothing cared except Papa and me. The world was exactly like it had been and would always be, going on about its business. We must have sat on the ground several minutes before we got the strength to pick up Messenger and carry him up the trail. Papa and me took turns toting the body, and we got to the house in the first light of day. Mama and Rosie was waiting up, with the lamp still burning on the mantle. After Messenger died, there was just us four girls in the family, Lou and me and Rosie and Carolyn, the youngest. Rosie was the oldest and Lou was next. After we lost Messenger, Carolyn got spoiled almost as bad as he had and never did a bit of work around the place. It was like we had to spoil somebody, and with no brother, it was just natural that Carolyn would be the one. Mama made Carolyn pretty pink dresses with lace and ribbons on them, and she fixed Carolyn's hair in ringlet curls and a pink bow. Carolyn looked more like a doll than a regular child. Papa's lungs had started to get a little weaker. When he got overworked or soaked in a storm or chilled by a draft in church, it would take him in the chest. He'd get his feet wet, mowing along the branch, and before midnight he'd be coughing and spitting into the fireplace. He had been a strong man, but the chest consumption weakened him all over. When his lungs hurt, he couldn't sleep, and when he coughed, none of us could sleep much either. The rest of us, except Carolyn, sure worked plenty. As Mama got older, she sometimes had back trouble and couldn't stand up straight, and had to walk bent over. It throwed more work on us girls when she was poorly. Rosie didn't mind doing her share of the housework. She never did like to work outside in the yard and fields, but she could cook things. She liked to sew and to knit. She could do embroidery and knit socks and sweaters and shawls. And she liked crocheting counterpanes and fancy pieces. Rosie would help to dust and clean up, but she preferred to be in the kitchen, or sitting by the fire with her yarn and a hook and a cat in her lap. Alou was the only one of my sisters that was willing to work outside. I don't think she liked it, but she was willing to help out. Like I said, when Papa got sick, it fell on me to take care of the stock and field crops. But Lou would pitch in and help. Biggest job the year round was to bring in wood, for we had to have fuel for the cook stove and the fireplace. We had to keep the house warm when Papa was coughing, and that meant load after load of wood. Ever since I was a girl, I had worked with Papa to cut firewood. But helping is one thing, and having to do it all yourself is another. Once Papa started taking to bed for long spells with his breath too short to get any air, Mama said somebody had to bring in the wagon loads and sled loads of wood, and had to cut and saw and split and tote it to the porch where Mama or Rosie or even little Carolyn could reach it, though Carolyn rarely touched anything as rough and heavy as wood. The job just fell to me, without anybody explaining why. And since it had to be done, I done it, and kept on doing it. For 5 Wednesdays in a row that winter, it snowed. And between the snows, it would sleet. And after every sleet come a thaw where everything started melting. Then when it turned cold again, the water froze, so there was layers of ice and snow like a fancy cake stacked in the woods. The snow got so hard and slick, the horse couldn't hardly walk on it. That was the month our cow slid off the pasture hill into the branch and lost her calf. The ground was slicker than a pane of glass. I don't think the horse can stand up, much less pull the sled, Lou said. Then we'll have to pull it ourselves, I said. I've heard of working like a dog, but never like a horse, Lou said. There wasn't no way to bring in the load of wood that I could see except pull the sled ourselves. We toted the axe and saw into the woods across the pasture where a bunch of trees had been knocked down by the ice. I broke a sheath of ice off a log before we begun sawing. Pretty soon sweat was running down my back and around my temples, though it was below freezing in the woods. I hope no man ever sees us working like this, I said. Lou pulled the cross-cut saw back to her and gasped. Why not? Because he would never think of us as ladies, I said. We're not ladies, Lou said. I don't want to be looked on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.